I'm gonna have to learn how to honk.
Excuse me. I actually left the house today and I'm tired.
Yeah.
Wow, sounds nice.
I have the day off work, so I did not leave my house.
Yeah.
I literally did so much shit today. I juggled like 14 different children. I changed diapers. Yesterday, one of my little friends at the end of the day scooped up a handful of thumbtacks and threw it grenade style into an open classroom door.
Nice.
And like,
I love children.
That's really cool, but also dangerous. Yeah. Like, it was really funny. It was really funny in retrospect, but at the time I was like, you could have killed another child.
Yeah.
Anywho.
Makes me feel any better. The car that I just took possession of is potentially broken, so that's fun.
I mean, no, that doesn't make me feel better.
It's okay. Okay, let's do the intro, because we're veering onto announcement rant territory, so let's do the intro first.
Okay. Hey, guys, you're listening to The Triad, where we're spooky but sensitive. I am Shelby.
Am I next? I'm Hannah.
Yes. I'm Shannon.
What the hell? There's, like, a really weird thing coming up on mine.
Yeah, that was static. Wait. Again.
Okay, I couldn't tell. Why? If that was just my headphones or Hannah.
No, it's Hannah.
Because I can't hear it.
I know you
That's
can't.
That's so weird.
I don't know.
Anyway, do we have any announcements?
I don't think so. I'm moving in 21 days.
Yeez.
Yeah. I'm not packed because I can't pack because my other roommate, one of them, is also moving out. So the apartment's full of her boxes and they're not going to be gone until Wednesday, so I can't pack anything.
Yeah.
Which is fine. I have plenty of time. It's just I want to pack, because there's also just, like, too much stuff in my apartment right now, and it's making me anxious.
Yeah.
You know? But it's whatever. I think that's it. Oh, yeah, my new-to-me car might be broken somehow, but it's fine. My stepdad owns an auto repair shop, so, like, we'll get it fixed, but...
Yes.
He owns
but
a
until
shop
then.
Not near Chicago, though, so if something does need to get fixed up here, we have to try to find me a shop up here.
Yay.
Yeah.
That sounds expensive.
Yeah. It's fine. It's fine. I think that's it, though, because, I mean, I'm not doing anything this summer. Like, I'm done with law school, and my nothing for my master's program starts until, like, the middle of August, so.
Yeah.
I'm not doing anything. Good. Which is nice,
though. I am not moving until August, but I'll be, like, back and forth between, like, June and July.
Yeah.
But I'm not, like, officially moving.
Yeah.
Until August, so.
Yeah, I'm gonna be driving back and forth long with you, probably.
Right.
As long as my car doesn't explode.
Yeah, hopefully. That would be
I just got that. I literally have had it for 8 days. It has been my car. 8 days! Or no.
You know what? The universe said you don't need it.
No, apparently not. It's fine. Hannah, did you have any announcements?
I spent 5 hours in IKEA the other day.
As you should.
That's it. I mean,
IKEA,
I had a good time.
Is the Holy Land.
I went to the IKEA in one of the suburbs today just to get out of my house. And that was how I found out my car might be dying when I was, you know, driving to IKEA on the interstate. So that was fun.
That's
fucking
fun.
I-90, which is the most congested... Oh my god, the traffic on 90 is terrible right now because they're doing construction. Anyway, I went to IKEA today. I didn't buy anything, but I saw a bunch of stuff I did want to buy. So,
as always.
Yeah. I also went to Michael's and got more cross-stitching thread for my giant thing that I'm working on.
So my announcement... is that I hurt myself this weekend. My brain is not working because I am concussed. Because I was at work and I was taking out cardboard and I slammed the back of my head into the corner of the steel cardboard compactor.
Yeah.
And basically, I was, like, I, like, it hurt, obviously. And so I was, like, holding my head. But then I, like, put the rest of the cardboard in and, like, left. And then as I was walking back to our store, like, I was still holding my head. And then I was, like, why does my hand feel wet? And I brought it down and my hand is just, like, covered in blood.
Yeah, that'll
do. So I, like, get back to our store. And I was, like, I'm gonna go in the back and have a panic attack. Don't mind me. I'll be back in a minute. And then I was not back in a minute because my head was gushing blood. And, yeah, so we got it to stop bleeding. I was wearing a white scrunchie that day. Had to throw that away.
Yeah.
I had blood in my hair my entire shift at work. And then gross. I went to urgent care and, but yeah, so, I went to urgent care. I just have a tiny little hole in my head. It wasn't bad enough for, like, stitches or a staple or anything. And then I have a concussion, so.
Yeah.
I've been very dizzy and very, like, not with it and very tired for the last few days. It's fine.
So I was over at family's house when that happened, and I showed the picture to my grandma. Who was sitting next to me. God bless her. And she was like, oh, because, okay, Lucy is in, my sister Lucy is in cosmetology school. And she goes, oh, yes. Is that a, like, a dye job that Lucy did? I was like, no, that's no. Blood on my friend's scalp. She's like, oh, good, because it looked really bad. Like, just the blood part.
That's funny. I mean, to be fair, I just sent the pictures to my parents, and my dad was like, you know, I don't really like that new color you're dyeing your hair. I was like, yes, yes, blood, blood red, dad. Yes.
Yeah.
So,
oh my God.
Yeah, blood just, like, in the, on the crown of my head, of course. This is exactly what I was going for.
Right. It's a very specific look.
Are we done with announcements?
Yes.
Please, God, let us be done with announcements, okay?
but also, I am very tired, and so there's no telling what I'll say today.
That's okay. Okay, what are we talking about today, Shelby?
I have a PowerPoint for you guys.
You do. It's a
terrible one, but you're welcome.
That's okay.
It's in the episode 49 folder. We're talking about Gouverneur Morris, or Gouverneur Morris, sorry.
Yeah.
Giving you.
yes. Yuki, can you get away from my microphone? Okay, cool. Thanks.
Not a chance.
Yeah, so today we're going to be talking about Gouverneur Morris, who he was a founding father of the United States. He signed the Articles of Confederation and the United States Constitution. And he's actually the man who wrote the preamble to the United States Constitution, and he's sometimes referred to as the penman of the Constitution, mm-hmm. Just because he was part of the committee that, like, wrote it, and he actually wrote most of it. But he lived a very interesting life. So we're going to be talking about him. I will apologize because the entire time I was writing my notes, I was also singing random snippets of songs from Hamilton.
Yep.
I have still never seen Hamilton, nor have I heard
it is on Disney Plus, ma'am.
All the way through.
Disney Plus.
I hate being sad, so I'm not going to do it.
Most of it's not sad. It's just the end.
I don't care.
Okay.
And
anytime
I don't
someone
think...
tries to watch a movie with me, I'm like, I'm not emotionally prepared to watch this movie. And they're like, okay. And it's just always for every movie ever.
Okay.
I mean, fair. But yes, I don't think any of the snippets of songs actually made it into my notes. But chances are that I will just start randomly singing part of it. And mm-hmm. Let me just tell y'all right now, I am not Lin-Manuel Miranda, so...
To be fair, Lin-Manuel Miranda is kind of a shitty singer, so he'll probably do better than he does.
Wow, triggered.
Okay, it is
rude,
a stark...
But okay.
No, I'm not the only person to hold this opinion, believe me. It is a stark, because I've seen Hamilton twice, live. It is such a difference hearing a professionally trained Broadway singer sing as Hamilton versus the audio, like the original Broadway cast recording, especially on Hurricane. I cannot listen to Hurricane because I hate how he sings. It's horrible. So, yeah.
Okay, I'm not saying he's a great singer, but also rude. Because he did great on the Moana soundtrack.
He barely sang on it.
Okay, but he did great.
Yeah. No, I'm just saying, in Hamilton, it's not his best. The Broadway cast recording is not his best, in my opinion. And again, if you see it live, it's very, with different cast, it's just very noticeable.
Well, obviously, because a professionally trained Broadway singer has had vocal training their whole life. Like, duh, they're going to be better.
Yeah. I'm not...
Are we really fighting about this right now?
Like...
No.
Can we please move on?
Wow. Wow, Hannah doesn't want to fight with me today.
No, I just bought stuff for tacos, and I'm real excited.
She's excited about her tacos.
I, to be perfectly candid, I have not cooked myself a meal in, 3 weeks.
That's
fine. I've just been living off of microwave food and DoorDash, and I've been eating a
lot of buttered noodles, so...
Yeah.
It's all good.
I love it.
Anyway, okay, so, Gouverneur Morris, he was born in, also, because I didn't want to call him Morris, and, because I don't know why I don't like calling people by their last names, in these things, I just don't, and then, I didn't want to type out Gouverneur 800 times, so I just called him Gov, so.
That's fair.
I might just call him that, we'll see. We'll see what I do. But anyway, so he was born in 1752 on his family's estate in what is now New York City, specifically what is now the Bronx, for anyone who cares. But
can you imagine if these founding fathers talked like they were from the Bronx?
I know. When I first wrote that, I was like, the Bronx.
Dude, I love it.
But yeah, his mother's maiden name was Gouverneur because she was from France, so that's where he got his name from.
Gotcha.
And in French and in Dutch, it means governor, but...
What a shock!
Not really relevant. Yeah.
If it meant anything else, my brain would have exploded. I just would have been like, what? What do you mean it doesn't mean governor?
Yes.
It means cobbler.
Yeah. But yeah, so his mother, her name was Sarah Gouverneur. She was a Huguenot from France. And if you don't know what a Huguenot is, basically they were a religious group from France. They followed the Calvinist or Reformed traditions of Protestantism. Basically just means they were on the other side of Protestantism from Lutherans. So
I saw the funniest TikTok today about Huguenots. I'm gonna send it to you later.
You have the strangest
TikTok,
Santa.
How did you get a TikTok about Huguenots?
It was just about, like, it was like medieval boomers. Or not medieval boomers, like 1600 boomers. And they're like, well, these, how's it racist? What's racist about calling these Huguenots? And then, like, they said a bunch of racist shit about the French.
Okay, please send that to us.
It was so funny.
Oh, gosh. Okay. Yes, yesterday Hannah was sending me TikToks about how to be a Victorian vampire. So
Victorian dandy. Shout out to Ghost Honey. You are my favorite human being in the world, and if you could be my friend, I would die happy.
Okay. Anyway. Okay, so she was a Huguenot from France. Her family had basically moved to Holland and then to New Amsterdam. Not really relevant. I just put it in my notes. And then she was the second wife of Gouverneur's father, who was Louis Morris Jr., and he was a wealthy judge and landowner in New Amsterdam. Basically, they were both, like, both of his parents were loyalists, so, which, I don't know, I just thought it was interesting that his mother was, she was, like, a really strong loyalist, even though she had no ties to the British monarchy.
Interesting.
Yeah, so, didn't the French and the British fucking hate each other?
The French aided the American colonies to end the Revolutionary War.
But I don't know.
And then they were like, hey, will you help us with our revolution? We were like, about that.
Yeah,
so maybe not.
And then we just Britain and France had just, they have a really long history of hating each other. I also do want to say New Amsterdam eventually became New York. Just yes. so everyone yes. is aware, in case people yes. did not know.
Oh, yeah, I probably should have clarified that. But it's fine. Yeah. But yeah, so because she was the second wife to Lewis Morris Jr., Gouverneur had multiple half-siblings, one of which was a signer of the Declaration of Independence, and that was Lewis Morris the Third, I suppose. There is a bug in my bedroom. Why? Oh, God. Oh, it's just a little baby moth. Okay. You're fine. And then one of his other half-siblings was a loyalist and a major general in the British Army during the American Revolution. Great. That was Stotts Long Morris, I believe is how you say his first name.
She says, hold on, she said, can I say this on here? Her TikTok just
I haven't watched she said, it.
I know, but she's saying, wait, what's racist about saying that the Huguenots are a bunch of sneaky money, scrounging, no good? Hold on, it's French froggos.
Oh my gosh. I don't think the Huguenots exist anymore, so.
Probably not. I'm gonna Google it.
Okay.
Are the Huguenots real? Question. Just
kidding. And then Gouverneur's grandfather, who was the original Lewis Morris, he was the Chief Justice of New York, and he was a British governor of New Jersey.
Okay.
So, basically, like, as far as their family ties go, as, like, where they were tied to with, like, being loyalist or with independence and all of that, they were kind of all over the place. Mostly the older generations were loyalists, and then Gouverneur and a couple of his siblings were more on the, like, let's have independence side. Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah, that was pretty
cool. I apologize to all of the French Protestants who are what the Huguenots have become. I take back my statement. It was just a TikTok I was reading. I don't actually know anything about Huguenots. I can't make an informed opinion about any of you people.
Okay.
But yeah, even if you like read up on like where their family stood with things, a lot of it was, it wasn't so much that they were loyalists because they wanted freedom, but they didn't want independence, if that makes any sense.
They just wanted more rights, but they didn't want to be a separate country, probably, is what it sounds like.
Yeah,
to
it's
me.
Yeah, essentially they like wanted to like his mom, like she wanted religious freedom and stuff like that. And so like they wanted the freedoms and the rights and everything that came with like living in America. They just also thought that independence sounded too difficult to start a nation.
That's
essentially
fair.
And so yeah.
Yeah.
And that is where the first Hamilton reference came into my brain, because the King George songs are my favorite.
Yes.
Because it's just, he's so sassy, and mm-hmm. I love it. But anyway.
That King George was also cuckoo, so that was part of it too.
Well, yeah. Just a little cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs. But yeah, okay. I never told you to go to the second slide, but you can go to the second slide.
Okay.
Oh, also, because I am not actually on my PowerPoint, and I made this like 10 minutes ago, so I barely remember what's on it. But the first slide says, Gouverneur Morris, the rake who wrote the Constitution. And then in tiny, it says, that's not my title or intellectual property. I am not that clever. I will get into where that title comes from later on. The second slide is just a general picture of Gov. So.
Yes.
Yeah. You know, like I said, it's not a good PowerPoint, but it's there.
There's one at all, which is not the norm for you.
For me. Yeah. Yeah. But yeah. So, Gouverneur was a smart child by all accounts. He was a gifted scholar. And he enrolled at King's College at the age of 12. Which I don't know if that's young or normal for back then. I probably should have looked that up. But
well, weren't colleges back then also sometimes just high school? Like, it was, like, secondary education. Like, you learn how to read and then you go to college.
Yes, but he graduated in 1768 at 16 years old. So, and then he had his master's from King's College at 19 years old.
What was his degree in, like...
I don't know.
Stepping
but he,
over the cow he, shit, not, like, being inside of it, like everyone else at the time? I don't know.
Okay. I don't know. Whatever. It's however school worked back then. It doesn't matter.
I don't know why I'm being so hostile. I'm just... I just have questions.
It's because you haven't had your tacos yet.
Okay, it's because tacos. I'm hangry.
There we go. Okay.
For tacos. Yes.
But regardless, for those who don't know, King's College is now Columbia University in New York City.
Yeah.
Also.
I will say, I don't know what the minimum age cutoff was, but up until, like, fairly recently, you could kind of just go to college as long as you could read, so.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, but let I mean, me like, tell you, because I taught some of those people. He was intelligent,
so.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know, like, what the... entrance requirements were, but
you know, in like 1762, I have no idea what it was like.
Yeah, and I don't know how their like degree, like the degrees worked. I don't know if you majored in something. I don't know how that
worked. Yeah, I honestly don't know, and I didn't look it up because
it's not again, like
it's not relevant to what we're talking about. Because after, because like I said, he graduated in 1768 and then he got his master's degree in 1771 at 19 years old. But after getting his master's, he studied law under a judge, so it was more like an apprenticeship.
Mm-hmm. That
so,
used to be more common. In the U.S.
Yeah, and so I have a feeling that's more of what it was like, and so I don't, again, I don't know how the schooling system worked, and frankly, in this specific episode slash case, I don't really care, honestly. Yeah. So, but yeah, so he studied law under Judge William Smith, who later on in, like, the 1780s, he became the Chief Justice of the Province of New York, Oh, sorry, my body's dying. but, so the man knew what he was doing, and then he, like, after New York, he, like, because he was, like, a real strict loyalist, he, after America gained its independence, he was one of those where he was like, I'm moving to Canada. and yeah, so he became, like, the Chief Justice of Quebec or something like that.
I will say... You can, so, like, we didn't used to always have, like, we haven't always had, like, a bar of some kind that you have to join. Like, we do, but it wasn't, like, as difficult to get into as it is now.
Yeah.
And in some states, including California, you can still become an attorney without going to law school if you do an apprenticeship and pass the bar.
Yeah.
That's what Kim Kardashian is slash was doing. I don't know if that's still happening. But
we're not going to get into my opinions on that.
No, but like it is possible. I don't know if it's not really recommended, but you can do it at least in some states.
Right. Well, and like Gouverneur, he did gain admission to the bar in 1775, but that's how they worded it. It wasn't that he like passed the bar exam or anything. It was that he gained admission to the bar.
Yeah. And I mean, that's how it is still. Like technically once you pass the exam, you have been admitted to the bar. We just added that requirement. And I'm sure there was some kind of an exam he had to pass, but I can pretty much guarantee it was not as rigorous as the modern day bar exam.
For sure.
Can you read these four words?
Yeah.
Cool.
Do you know what a law is? A yes or no?
Do you know how to yell objection?
Yeah.
Good.
You're also the barber lawyer. And the sheriff.
Yeah, good for you. Go pull some teeth while you're writing a legal document.
Right.
Have fun.
I'm not saying that Gouverneur wasn't intelligent because he was, by all accounts, like very intelligent, very much a gifted scholar.
Yeah.
I'm just saying that I don't know what that would make him in today's standards. Okay. Yeah.
I mean, I feel like if he were in today's standards, he would probably still be an attorney of some kind. Like he's still, I don't see any reason why he wouldn't.
Right. Like, cause if you can like make it onto the Continental Congress and all of that and like,
yeah. Like, you must not be a
complete journal. Like, you wrote the Declaration, or no, he didn't write the Declaration of Independence, but he did, like, write, like, the Constitution, that one.
Yeah. Thomas Jefferson wrote the Declaration of Independence.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know. Yeah. You know, one of those people with shady ideals.
Yeah.
But
it was just a very different.
He wrote the Constitution, so obviously he wasn't an idiot. So
no,
I'm saying. Yeah. Yuki, stop. It was just a very microphone different... is not a cat scratch.
Hey,
it's just a very different academic culture and
Yuki,
programs and everything that it is now. Hannah, are you okay?
That just bit me.
I was turning the nails. Oh man,
Yuki, just come lay on my lap, you. Okay?
Everybody, go soothe your demon cats. And
right. I bought a shirt the other day that says, like, caring for your demon pet, and it's a picture. It's a picture of a cat with, like, several things.
I can hear Peppa. Sorry.
Peppa's very unhappy right now.
She does this thing. Hold on. I'll tell you in a minute.
Okay.
Stop it.
Sounded so severe. Stop it.
Right?
She keeps getting stuck on furniture, and she'll, like, twist her arm, and I feel really bad for her. But anyway, she does this thing when I'm cutting her nails where she jumps before I even shut or close the, like, cut the nail.
Yeah.
So, like, I'm so afraid to do it because if she jumps while I'm doing it, then she's going to hurt herself.
Yeah.
You're a dork.
I forgot this is related
eat your
to
kibble and glare
our pets
at me,
being weird.
Whatever.
I told Shelby this when I was home at my mom's house. So Maisie doesn't recognize no as no. You know what I mean? Like, I'll say no, and she just looks at me like, "What the fuck does that mean?" I have to basically honk at her and go like, "Eh!" Like, that is the only thing she recognizes is no.
It's hilarious.
I don't know how that happened.
But I'm gonna have to learn how to honk.
Yeah. Like, she listens to it, but I'm like, that's what you picked up to be the no command, not no.
Right.
No, it's me going, eh. Ugh, it's fine. It works, and she's not going to get confused with anybody else saying no, because...
Right.
Ugh, okay, sorry. Let's get back to Gov here.
All right. I basically already said this, but yeah, he gained admission to the bar in 1775 at the age of 22.
Okay.
So, and then also in 1775, he became a member of the New York Provincial Congress. And along with the other delegates, they basically focused on making the colony an independent state. That was kind of their goal with the Provincial Congress.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, because the older folks in his family were all loyalists, that kind of put him at odds with his family and mm-hmm. And with his mentor, and basically his mentor was like, yeah, no, not hanging out with you no more. But, you know, whatever, it's fine. And then in my notes, I was like, it put him in conflict with his family and his mentor, but c'est la vie. this whole episode is just going to be me referencing other things, but every time I say c'est la vie, it just makes me think of Easy A, where, if you have seen it, then you'll know the scene, but basically Emma Stone's character, Olive, goes c'est la vie, and then Woodchuck Todd's character goes la vie, and they're like, ha, funny, look at the joke. Anyway, it's funnier in the movie.
Yes.
Because Emma Stone is a much funnier human being than I am.
God, that movie's amazing.
It's one of my comfort movies, my
it's
emotional support movies.
It's 10 years old.
It is, and I
shut
still
up.
Can
quote every word of it.
It came out 2011.
I watched that movie. I have seen that movie so many times I can literally quote it word for word.
I know.
So.
Oh, I love that movie.
That's
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it came out in 2011.
I think so, yeah.
2010 or 2011.
It was a long... It was... Yeah.
It was a while ago. Oh, excuse me.
And then this is kind of just a side note, but also kind of like highlights the fact that he was at odds with his family during the Revolutionary War. When the British seized control of New York City after the Battle of Long Island, Gouverneur's mother actually, like, opened up their family estate to the British for them to use for their military and essentially, like, kicked Gouverneur out of the house so that she could do that. She was like, "You're not gonna embarrass me in front of the British military." And, yeah.
Yeah.
Also, I don't know where that voice came from, so...
Because they live in the Bronx!
Yeah.
But she's French. What is that even like? I just imagine Marie Antoinette to yelling at
him. Oh, poor Marie Antoinette.
Yes. Yeah. Which, another fun fact, later on we'll learn about how Gov was an ambassador to France, and he was actually, like, sympathetic to Marie Antoinette's side of things, so.
Good, he should have been.
Yeah. But yeah, so that was him being at odds with his family. He wanted independence. He was also a member of the New York State Assembly in 1777 and 1778. And then in January, this is all just a lot of, like, back history before we get to the actual interesting parts of his life.
Okay.
Not that the historical part, like, historical relevant part of his life isn't interesting, but you know.
Comparatively, there's other more interesting things we're going to get to.
Yeah. Like, this is stuff that's interesting to, like, me and Shannon and Hannah only. Yeah. So.
And, like, honestly, I'm not, like, super into, like, Revolutionary War stuff. There's nothing against it. It just wasn't my area, so I don't actually know, like...
I was a Civil War and World War II child,
I don't know anything about this dude, so...
Yeah. Really quick question. Did you two ever watch Liberty Kids growing up?
The best show!
I fucking remember.
Loved that show.
Let me Google it.
Oh my god. You would Google remember it. It was just like...
Okay, it was the best remember, show Remember, my brain doesn't work, grade.
So...
Yeah, Shannon doesn't have memories.
I mean, I watched this. I did. Yeah. I've seen this. I don't remember literally anything about it, but I have seen it.
I used to have the theme song memorized, but I forgot it a couple years ago.
Aw. So...
Yuki, what are you... Oh, you found the bug. Okay.
Go hunting.
I hear jingling.
What about Sounds Liberty Kids, Hannah?
True predator. Oh, no, I was just thinking, because, like, I have an American Girl doll, and it's Felicity, so uh-huh. I was always into the revolutionary mm-hmm. period. The actually more like colonialism. Yeah. I don't like colonialism. Like, okay. The practice. I like the furniture and the clothing that came out of this time period.
That's fair.
That's how I feel about the 20s.
The architecture. Yeah, everything else was shitty. Like, let's not take indigenous lands and let's not, like...
Practice eugenics.
Right,
yeah,
like,
all
yeah.
that shit, whatever.
Let's, However, maybe allow some feminism, nice but flapper dresses chair, are super cute. Okay? So,
yeah.
Like.
I had two American Girl dolls. I had Kit, who was Great Depression, and then Samantha,
Kit
who
is
was,
the
like,
best one.
1910s New York, I think. 1910s somewhere. I can't remember where.
All I have to say is that the American Girl dolls were the best, and their books were amazing.
Mm-hmm. I love the Felicity books.
They don't, like...
There is a man in that book named Jiggy Nye. What? There's nothing better than that. Jiggy Nye.
Yeah.
She well, and honestly...
Felicity...
Like,
Merriweather steals a horse from fucking Jiggy Nye.
Yeah. I think I read most of the books, but I only had those two dolls. That was more than most people had.
I didn't have one of the, like, historical American Girl dolls. I had the one that, like, looked like me, except she didn't because her hair was straight, but...
Yeah.
They
don't, like, do the historical ones anymore. I don't
yeah.
think.
Yeah, they retired Felicity.
But I had Samantha. All of Kit's outfits. I think they have new historical ones. Okay. So, in January of 17... the second one. Okay. The one of the picture of him. We're not moving on very far.
That's fine.
So, in January of 1778, Gouverneur was appointed to the Continental Congress, and he served on the committee in charge of military reforms, and he worked alongside George Washington with this. They did a bunch of stuff. Basically, they, like, went and visited a fort, and they were like, this is appalling. the way that they live and, I don't know, like, got them food and supplies and stuff like that. But, again, not really relevant to what I am eventually going to get to. And then also in 1778, Gouverneur was one of the people who signed the Articles of Confederation, and he actually was the youngest person to sign them. Also, I know this isn't really, like, your time period, but do either of you know about the Conway Cabal?
I don't think so. Not that okay. I can.
It sounds so familiar.
Yeah, it sounds familiar, but I could not tell you what
is
it
that
is.
Is that a Dollop episode?
Maybe. basically, it was just within the Continental Congress, there was a faction or, like, a group of people who wanted to court-martial George Washington so that he would no longer be in charge.
Oh.
Yeah.
Interesting.
So, but during that situation, and that was also in 1778, during that situation, Gouverneur was the one who cast the tie-breaking vote that kept George Washington as the commander-in-chief of the military.
Oof.
That's
really close. Like, for that kind of a decision.
Yeah.
It's a tiebreaker.
Yeah. Ugh. And to, like, leave it up to your, like, youngest member. Yeah. But he had worked with George Washington, with the Continental Congress, on that, like, military reform committee. And so he was like, well, we're friends, so yeah, I guess.
Yeah. Also, I love
I would hope he put more thought into it than that.
I mean,
that,
he probably did. I love that our military was immediately so shitty that we immediately had to reform it.
Yep.
Well,
like, we're not even a country yet. And
I'm gonna stop you right there. George Washington, if there's one thing I do know a lot about, it is military history. Thanks,
true.
Dad.
Yep. Same.
George Washington brought in this guy named, oh my god, he was some German, Baron von
something.
Some shit.
Yeah.
Who came in and basically, like, made the military what it is now. Like, everyone who was at Valley Forge and whatever, sorry, I'm trimming my talons. he, like, came in and changed it all, which, yeah, I guess it was a little bit, he needed some stuff to be done, but really, we had such a good military from the beginning that we just can't stop, won't stop. I mean, I don't support the military-industrial complex or whatever, but, like, we've always been pretty good at it.
Yeah. I will say, too,
Shannon, go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say, we didn't even have a standing military at the time. It was all, like, colonial regiments, and then later on it was state regiments. So it wasn't even, like, a standing military, which was part of the reason why it was, like, the conditions were so shitty, was because it was up to, like, the colony and just all this other stuff. So I will say that.
And, like, the reforms that they did were more in, like, the conditions that the military was under. They brought in people to, like, train them so that they were actually less of, like...
Baron von what's-his-face.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I used to know, but now, of course, because you said it, I can't remember. It was more about, like, to get them trained so they weren't just, like, these kids with, like, sticks and whatnot. So,
yeah.
And then also just, like, their living conditions, making sure they had the supplies they needed, stuff like that.
Friedrich Wilhelm von Steuben.
Yeah, that
dude. So you were pretty close with Baron What's-His-Shit, so...
I said Baron Von was his shit, so I knew what was up.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
Did I write an essay about him?
I don't know.
I'm pretty sure he was in Liberty Kids, too.
Probably. I almost wrote an essay about him. You know the essay that sent me to Washington for that contest?
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Almost wrote about him for it. But then I was like, that's stupid. And then I didn't.
Gotcha.
And then my lobbyist essay won. I was like, I'm going to be a lobbyist for fucking education. Kiss ass. Like, oh my god, send her to Washington.
That's how you do it.
Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah, okay, so he was the tiebreaker vote to keep Washington as commander-in-chief of the military. And then here is exactly how I wrote it in my notes. Some other stuff happened. It's probably important, but we're not here to talk about his career, so if you want to know about it, you can look it up. That's honestly fair. Wikipedia does a really good job of laying it out chronologically and in an easy to consume fashion, so I would just recommend the Gouverneur Morris Wikipedia page if you want to know about that. Just know that at some point he ended up in Philadelphia. Okay. There you go. That's my very succinct summation. Basically, he like lost.
I love that we're historians.
Right. Basically, he just like lost the next election or like whatever to be on the New York State Assembly, and then he moved to Philadelphia to be a lawyer. That's
yeah, really. Just imagine, and I'm gonna butcher this, but in his New York accent, which didn't exist, just being like, "Look, I'm already named Gouverneur. Like, come on." Yeah.
Just make me the governor. Yeah, basically.
Oh my god. I'm so sorry to everyone from New York. I'm related to all of you, and I don't know your accent. I was not raised in your culture. I did start watching Law and Order again yesterday.
There you go.
Have I ever mentioned that I hate that show?
I think you have.
Yeah. Anyway. Law and Order? I'm watching Law and Order SVU.
Is yeah, I hate that one.
You hate as well. Okay, cool. Sorry.
I hate all of them, but it's okay. We're not gonna get into it.
It's they're very problematic. I just like to have it on in the background as like white noise while I scroll through other things on my phone.
Yeah, I'm just saying if you want to fight me about it, DM me about it, but also don't because I won't answer you. But I do have valid reasons. Okay, so in 1787, Gouverneur was selected as a delegate for the to represent Pennsylvania during the Constitutional Convention.
There we go.
Apparently, I can only say it if I'm pretentious about it.
That's okay.
And while at the Constitutional Convention, he was chosen for the Committee of Style and Arrangement, which was
apparently a motorcycle in my bedroom.
You're also staticky again.
No,
well,
that
that's
would be
the motorcycle in her bedroom.
Ah.
Yes. But yeah, so he was chosen for the Committee of Style and Arrangement, and that was essentially the group. There was about five people on that committee, and they were the group that drafted the final language of the proposed Constitution for the United States. Oh, if you would like to go to the next slide to look at the Constitution, sure.
Can you imagine how much fun that would have been?
Just be like, no, we need to word it this way.
No, because it's you're picking apart words. Like, there's like one verb in there, and you're like, no, that's too weak. We need to be much stronger.
That's
literally what they did.
Except
I know.
For when.
I mean, that's why it's the Committee of Style and Arrangement. It's literally just picking better words.
Yeah.
I know what it is. I'm saying it would have been fun to be on it.
Oh, no, I'm agreeing with you.
Okay, I think the problem is, Shelby, I think it's because you're tired. You sound like you hate us again.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I think it's because you're tired.
I'm exhausted today.
No, I know.
I think that's both the managers at work have been gone this week, so, like, I was left like, in charge, and that's never a good thing.
No, I think language.
I've been noticing that the further we've been getting in, I'm like, Shelby sounds like she's really mad at us. I'm pretty sure it's just because she's tired, though.
No, when I get tired, for some reason, I just, like, sound angry, and I'm not, I promise. Yeah. But...
And I'm not.
That's what it was. With the Constitution, they were really picky about their words, except for when they talked about impeachment. They were irritatingly vague about how to impeach people and what a high crime and misdemeanor is and what the process is and all that.
No. Sorry, the ice cream truck is going by, and I don't think anybody on the podcast who listens to the podcast knows this, but I have a massive phobia of ice cream trucks. So
I didn't know that. Why are you afraid of ice cream trucks?
Because if you have ever seen Chitty Chitty Bang Bang,
what? Oh,
the child snatcher.
Yeah.
Oh,
who disguised his little child snatching cart as a candy cart and played this song, and I was convinced that the ice cream truck was a child snatcher and I was going to get kidnapped. Also, my dad's like PTSD and paranoia as a security officer did not help that. And so I just have this massive fear of ice cream trucks now, and I am well aware that it is irrational and stupid, but also now I really want ice cream.
That's why it's a phobia. Those are usually irrational.
Well, yes, I am aware that that is the definition of a phobia, but...
Yes.
Do you want to hear a stupid fear of mine that I held until, I would say, roughly the middle of high school?
Yes.
I think it stemmed from a dream I had when I was quite young, but I was totally convinced that Culver's, like, the burger place, used to just, like, use children in their ketchup. It was like, what? So, the insides of, I know.
Listen. I was expecting you to finish that sentence with burgers, and you did not.
Been in the burgers too, but it was like mostly the ketchup I was concerned about. I think it was just because everything in there was chrome, and I was like, there's something going on here. Why is no one picking up on the thing that's going on here? Like, I don't know, it was all too tidy, you know what I mean?
Okay.
That's why I don't eat tartar sauce.
Again.
I just don't like tartar sauce. Can we get back to the actual topic, please?
As soon as I explain my tartar sauce aversion, it's because my dad made a joke one time that the little green bits in tartar sauce were cut up tartars. And for some reason, my child brain decided that because it was green and my dad said it was tartars, that it just made a person. And I thought it was like little army men, and I thought they were real people who got cut up and put in tartar sauce, so.
Well, my dad says that molasses is made out of mole asses, so.
Just be careful of the things you say to your children. You might scar them for life. Okay, thanks.
This has been triggered by three triggered people.
I was not involved in that conversation.
But anyway, I am 28 years old, and I am deathly afraid of ice cream trucks. Okay.
Okay. Let's go to the top.
Where were we? Constitutional Convention.
Yes.
But yeah, so essentially Gouverneur was the one who wrote most of the draft, and he was the one responsible for its final polished form. So, like, yes, the other guys had input and stuff, and they helped him with, like, word choice and things like that, but he is the one who actually wrote most of it. Okay. So
I can blame him for us not knowing what to do for an impeachment.
Go for it.
I would love to have someone to blame.
And then for this next point, it's, again, not necessarily related to what I will eventually be talking about, but I think it should be noted that he did not actually care for democracy.
That's a great trait for a founding father of a democratic nation to have. What did he prefer? Please tell us.
He supported a strong central government ruled by the aristocracy, with voting being limited to only property owners.
So he wanted Britain again.
Yes.
Just his own version of Britain.
He believed that the common people were incapable of governing themselves. Given the times,
maybe,
probably because they were uneducated. But whose fault is that? The aristocracy. Yeah.
That's
so, like,
why we have the electoral college. Sorry.
Yeah.
I was trying to find my words in there. For some reason, my brain thought it started with a C, and I was like, nope, and I almost said Constitutional Congress 5 different times. No, Electoral College.
Yeah.
That's why we have the Electoral College.
Yes.
It's because of that exact mentality.
Yeah, but yeah, so essentially he didn't necessarily believe in true democracy. I will say in one of the things, because he was an ambassador to France, like, later on, one of his descendants, I think it was like his niece or something, in a like memoir or something she wrote, she essentially said that, cause in France he was like sympathetic to Marie Antoinette and, I don't know, like, the revolutionary side of things, but basically she said that he kind of just supported whatever he thought the mentality of the people would be best suited for, if that makes sense. And so, yeah. Like, he didn't think that democracy would work in France because the French people wouldn't be able to handle it, essentially. So,
yeah,
it was kind of not that he had, like, a specific form of government that he did support. It was just that he didn't, first of all, he was from a wealthy land-owning family. Like, yeah. He was an aristocrat. So, like, obviously people in power want to stay in power.
Yeah.
But it was very much that he kind of just chose a form of government that he thought would work with the way that the people were.
Yeah.
So
just more practical consideration rather than sticking to a, I want this, make it work.
Yeah, more than, like, an ideal sort of thing.
Gotcha.
So, yeah. In a way, I understand where he was coming from, but I just thought it was kind of interesting that, like, you're a founding father and you don't believe in democracy.
Yeah. Like, which, I mean, to be fair. And also,
voting is dumb.
Yeah. I mean,
right.
For a very long time, only landowners were allowed to vote, so, like, he kind of got his way on that.
He kind of got his way.
Yeah.
However, that being said, he was one of only a very few delegates who openly spoke out against domestic slavery.
Cool.
Basically, his stance on it was that the point of the U.S. Constitution was to protect the rights of humanity, and to promote slavery was contradictory to that end, because you can't call someone both a man and property at the same time.
So, you know, yeah. I mean,
most people.
I mean, yeah.
Especially for the time, like, much better than most people, and even half the people today.
Yeah, cough. Apparently.
Cough. but, yeah, so basically, because I know a big proponent of slavery was that, like, they were essentially just not considered real people, but he was like, but we're calling them people.
Yeah.
Therefore, they cannot be property.
Yeah. They were 3/5 of a person.
Right.
For population counting purposes. But
that was later. Don't worry about that.
Yeah.
Yay, America. But yeah, so I thought that was very interesting.
Yeah.
So in, like, some ways he was very, like, forward-thinking, and other ways not so much, but, you know.
It's the 1700s. They thought very different things than we
so
do now.
So much to be expected.
Yeah.
And then, again, as I have it written in my notes, blah, 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 more career stuff. He went to France during their revolution. In 1800, he was elected to the Senate as a Federalist. And then from 1810 to 1813, he was chairman of the Erie Canal Commission. And he was one of the people who helped draw up the street grid for Manhattan, which, Manhattan is the one where it's, like, first, second, third, like, the streets go in order and then whatnot. And if you haven't lived in a
system, you simple bitch.
Yes.
To quote John Mulaney.
Yes.
If you have never been in a city that is not on a grid system.
It's hell.
Let me just tell you, and by a city that's not on a grid system, I mean St. Louis. Just know that every city ever should be on a grid system.
Dude, Chicago's on a grid system. It's awesome.
It's so nice. You always know where you are.
Yes.
You mean these roads shouldn't all be one way for no reason?
Yeah.
Right? You shouldn't just have some random circles. And then you just have, like, 18 million, like, 5-point crossings for no reason.
Yeah, or I think it's Boston. They just built their roads over where, like, carriage routes
where,
used
like,
to
the
be.
Dirt path.
Yeah.
Someone who fucking drove in Boston this weekend, let me tell you, that is some bullshit.
Yes, like.
Yeah.
Because, like, Minneapolis is set up It's like a modified grid system, but it's basically like if you're going north to south, and I'm probably going to get these mixed up, but if it's like if you're going north to south, they're numbered. If you're going east to west, it's like alphabetically. Mm-hmm. And it is so nice because you always know where you are. But like,
you know what else is dumb? Unpopular opinion. I fucking hate the thing in Missouri, in where did we live? Springfield, where you cross over the bridge on the opposite side.
Oh, that diamond thing? Oh, I hated that.
That's so stupid.
Oh, I hated that.
I don't understand the purpose. It does not make traffic flow better. No. It just makes tourists really scared.
It just makes you panic. Because you think you're on the wrong side of the road.
Like, yeah. There's like one or two of those in St. Louis, and they're stupid. I don't get it.
I hate it. Like, if you wanted to go to the good Indian restaurant in Springfield, you had to go across to, you had to drive on the wrong side of the fucking highway.
I don't know how to explain it other than however, I will say traffic circles when used correctly are very beneficial to keeping traffic flowing.
Yeah, everyone in Belleville, get your shit together.
That roundabout has been there for 100,000 years and they still don't know how to use it. It's ridiculous.
Honestly, they built the city around the roundabout and nobody gets it.
And nobody understands how to
use it. No one knows how to use it and it drives me insane every time I have to drive through that roundabout on my way to work every single day and every single day.
Don't wave me forward when you're in the circle. Keep going.
You're in the circle.
Stop. Don't stop.
Literally, there are signs that say yield to the traffic in the circle. So that
which they didn't even put those signs up until a few years ago, which just makes it worse.
Well, yeah, because they used to have lights at each exit.
Yeah.
Then what's the point?
Anyway.
Anyway. That concludes our rant on city planning.
Because now we're actually getting to the actual point of me talking about Gouverneur Morris.
Yay!
wait, it wasn't about to talk about traffic and Belleville?
I mean, look, I can get on a soapbox about that, but we're not going to.
Please don't.
So anyway, we're just going to be talking about his personal life, because he's got some interesting things that happened to him in his personal life.
Yay!
So basically, at 14, he accidentally dropped a kettle of boiling water on himself, which...
Dude!
Yeah.
My friend did that the other day. Someone I work with.
Yeah.
And she was out because her foot was just one giant blister.
Yeah.
Yeah, like, that shit hurts. But yeah, he ended up, like, scalding his entire right arm and, like, the entire side of, like, his torso and stuff.
Ugh.
And it caused him to miss an entire year's worth of classes at King's College, which,
remember, still graduated at
16. He still graduated at 16. So, like, if you ever want to feel bad about yourself, just remember that. Okay? At the time, he avoided getting gangrene, so he didn't have to have his arm amputated. But, in 1780, he was not so lucky. in 1780, he was in what was reported as a carriage accident.
Oh.
We'll get into it. And this quote-unquote carriage accident left his left leg severely broken in multiple places and his ankle was completely mangled. And his normal doctor was out of town when this happened, and so the attending physician said that he saw signs of gangrene and that the leg had to be amputated. So, Gouverneur gave his permission. They amputated his leg below the knee. And if you want to go to the next slide, he had to live the rest of his life with a wooden peg leg.
Sick.
Which, he looks like
like a posh Captain Ahab.
Right? Like, honestly. I say his normal doctor was out of town because, reportedly when his normal doctor came back into town, and the way it was worded, oh, also my sources are Wikipedia and the History Channel, but
glad we got that out of the way.
Or like history.com.
Yeah.
Like six different Wikipedia pages, but on the like history.com one, they were like, his normal doctor came back, and in a like, I don't know, something about like in a complete lack of bedside manner was like, nah, we could have saved your leg.
Ooh. So, just don't tell me that.
Right? Exactly. But yeah, so maybe he could have kept his leg. I don't know how, when you broke it that many times and you mangled up your ankle. It
especially back then.
Would have been less painful to amputate it, honestly, yeah. In the 1700s.
Yeah.
Or 1780.
Okay. Shove a copper bar in your mouth and get going.
We need to stop talking about medical stuff. I'm kidding.
Oh, that's right.
I can't do medical stuff for too long because I get lightheaded.
Gets woozy. Well, anyway, we're done with that.
Okay.
Not completely, but I do want to explain. Done with it.
Last year, or no, 2 years ago, I fainted at a bus stop because Christine on And That's Why We Drink was talking about a colonoscopy. I full on fainted at a bus stop from someone talking about a colonoscopy. I can't handle medical stuff, or like, I can't. I just can't do it.
It's weird. She can like watch it, but
yeah,
if
I can watch it. I can't talk about it. Like,
she freaks out.
The word surgery makes me. It makes my feet feel weird. Like all the blood's leaving my feet. It's really weird. It's happened for years.
We're sorry, that's just so specific.
I know. It's
it
really
makes my feet tingle.
It does. Ugh. Yeah, oh but I'm starting gosh. To get like I'm not getting lightheaded, but my brain's just like, hey, we need to move on now.
Yeah. We're done with the like amputation part of it.
Okay.
But anyway, the part where it was like it was reported as a carriage accident.
Yeah.
That is because, Gouverneur did not get married until later in life, and by later in life, I mean by the standards of the time, like, he got married at 57.
That is so, pretty like, late.
That's pretty freaking late for the 1700s. Yeah.
Yeah.
But he did have his, fair share of affairs throughout his entire life.
Mm-hmm.
And so in this particular instance, rumors started circulating that he had actually broken his leg while jumping from the balcony of his paramour in order to escape the wrath of her husband when he found them together.
I've heard that story before about a founding father, but I didn't know which one.
Yep. So that's this one. And basically, like, that rumor followed him for his whole life, so no one really knows what the actual cause of him breaking his leg was. So,
I was just drinking meat and driving.
Right? Yeah, totally.
Probably ale. That was back when we invented ale, right? I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Sure.
I don't know anything.
I don't know the history of beer. Or alcohol.
Yeah.
I was going to say, Shannon.
Yeah. Alcohol in general, I don't know the history of that.
To quote my college roommate really quick, it's not about alcohol, but similar. She said one time, I wouldn't know where to buy pot or weed.
Right.
Yes.
And I say it all the time.
Oh my gosh. Okay.
What's up, Jess?
But yeah, so that's kind of one of those where, it's one of those, like, fun facts about, like, America's founding father, like, America's weirdest founding father or whatever, that comes up sometimes.
Because Ben Franklin is right there.
Thomas Jefferson, Ben Franklin,
Jefferson was despicable.
Yeah.
They're all a little...
They're all kind of despicable. Look. On some level. It's a different degrees, but...
Yeah.
Variations on a theme.
Yeah.
Yep. For sure. But yeah, anyway, so Gouverneur did not let his loss of a leg slow him down. So sorry. I just
Okay, did you mean that as a double entendre or not? Do you mean in his like career or like as a hoe? Which one?
Or like
both?
Now really fast. With
Look, it can just mean so many things. Okay, it's fine. It just means all the things that you think it means.
Okay.
So, but there is a biography of him that was written by historian Richard Brookhiser, and the title of that biography is "Gentleman Revolutionary." Gouverneur Morris, the rake who wrote the Constitution, and that is why I titled my PowerPoint that. Mm-hmm. And in that biography, Richard Brookhiser basically states that Gouverneur, even after losing a leg, continued to ride horses, climb church steeples, shoot river rapids, and
and I love this man.
And shake his wooden leg dancing.
Oh, God.
Yes!
He also continued having multiple affairs with married women to the point that his friend John Jay wrote that he wished Gouverneur had lost something else during his accident. Oh,
my God. So. Can I, real quick, can I explain what a rake is? Because it's one of my favorite yes. things. Okay, and I yes. Googled it just to get a more, like, precise definition than my rambling. Yes. So, rake was short for rake hell, which was analogous to a hellraiser. It was a man who was habituated to immoral conduct, particularly womanizing. So he embodies yes. that very, very well.
Yep.
There's an Irish drinking song, which I am quite fluent at on the, fucking, what's it called? Tin whistle, called Gathering at the Rakes of Mallow. And it's just...
The Rakes of Mallow is
we played that song. In high school all the time. We played that in high school every St. Patrick's Day.
I would bring my flute in and play it. I'll go get it right now and play it for you if you want.
Let's not. No. I just sang it for them.
Yeah. There is,
Fine, you guys are no fun.
On...
Look, I love the Rakes of Mallow, okay?
The Decemberists sure have an album called, oh my God, The Hazards of Love. It's basically a musical, but they have a character in there called who is a rake, and that's like his character name. He doesn't actually have a name, and he has his own song, and he murders all his children to get away from them.
Yeah, his is so creepy.
It's great.
That album's so good. It's third. No, it's Friday. Okay,
it's Friday. That album's so good. Anyway. Yes.
But yeah, so this man, he was a rake. That's yes. what he was. So in 1792, George Washington appointed Gouverneur as a minister to France during the French Revolution. Okay. And he was actually the only diplomat that remained in Paris throughout the Reign of Terror. Mm-hmm. Everyone else was like, y'all are being real freaky right now. We're gonna peace out. And Gouverneur was like,
really obsessed with
this
like,
seems interesting. And then naturally, while he was in France, he had a couple of affairs.
Yep, seems
right. Yeah, most notably, he carried on a 3-year affair with a French novelist. I cannot say her name because it is French, and I do not speak that language. Her first name was Adelaide, so, and she was the wife of a... yes. and she was the wife of a count, and she happened to live in an apartment that was located inside of the Louvre. So this was before the Louvre...
to live there?
This was before the Louvre was converted into an art museum. However...
Is there a closet I can rent?
It is in all the articles that are like, the weirdest founding father. They're always like, Gouverneur carried out an illicit affair in the Louvre. It's like a fun fact, but yeah, it was technically before it was an art museum. Mm-hmm. But, and then he also shared this specific mistress with a French diplomat, Charles Maurice de Talleyrand, the man who sold the Louisiana Purchase to the U.S.
Right, yeah.
So, honestly, like, props to this lady.
Seriously.
She's, like, married to a count, gets to live in the Louvre, has all these, like, these famous...
famous boyfriends.
Men.
So great.
Yeah, like, she's a novelist in the 1700s. I don't know. I didn't look her up.
Do you know what her name was?
I will text it to you. Okay. But also, her name was different depending on, like, which article I was reading.
Yeah.
So, that's not helpful. Da, da, da.
And honestly, no, even if you could pronounce it, French has so many, like, silent letters in it that you wouldn't know how to spell it.
Yeah. So, yeah. Hold on. Let me type this out real quick. There you go, Hannah. But yeah. So that was one of his more famous affairs. He also had one. She was like an American poet and novelist. Basically, he just had a thing for married women. So, but yeah. And then during, which actually you can go to the next slide just because it was a funny picture I found.
Hot. Why did she look like she ran into a pole and now her whole face is black?
Because it's a painting from the 1700s. I can't help you. Okay. But yeah, and then during the Constitutional Convention, he was, this isn't really a funny fact, it's more just like a fun fact, but he was known for having spoken more than any other delegate. he delivered 137 speeches, which topped James Wilson's 168 and James Madison's 161.
What did he have to say?
So, the man liked to talk a lot. Chatting?
To be fair, he was, like, writing the Constitution, so I could understand why he's speaking so much. Again,
he was also, the like, one of very few at the time who, like, was speaking against slavery, so I would imagine there were quite a few of them about that.
He had a lot of opinions.
Yeah, you know, he didn't like democracy, like...
And another thing!
Basically. And, you know, probably half of his speeches were like, and I got a peg leg, so.
Yeah.
Anyone who wants to fight me, come get a piece of my peg leg.
Basically. And then he is the one credited with changing the preamble of the Constitution to what it is today, the We the People of the United States.
Form a more perfect union.
No. But I went to private Christian schools where we don't believe in the government.
Dude, I learned that in Catholic school.
Catholic school and private Christian school are two different things.
Okay, Hannah, I went to Baptist school in the South.
I retract my
Baptist
private
schools in the South. Okay,
two different things.
We don't believe in the government or anything. Okay. Except when the government agrees with us and lets us have our guns.
Yes.
Then we love them.
Yes.
But anyway, so, it was originally We the People of the States of New Hampshire, Massachusetts, etc., etc. It literally listed every of the, like, original states, or I guess 13 colonies, whatever, from north to south. And that's he was like, that's too wordy. We're gonna lose them. Yeah. We gotta make this succinct. We are the people of the United States.
Well, plus, like, so, it's supposed to be a living...
I don't know why I made this guy so sassy and, like...
I don't know.
New York?
Yeah.
But
it's, like, it's supposed to be a living document. It doesn't make sense to only list the currently existing states. They knew they were going to have
exactly.
more states. Like, that's just a dumb way to do that.
Oh, also, speaking of adding more states, he didn't... he didn't like the states to the west...
Like, just in general, or?
He didn't think that they should be allowed to vote because they weren't aristocrats. That was part of his...
Gotcha.
They were poor people. So
you and your ideas about democracy.
So this dude was like, nah. Virginia, Philadelphia, New York. We got it.
Philadelphia
we got
is
it
not
taken
state.
Care of. Here. Not Philadelphia. Pennsylvania. You know what I meant. But I am concussed. I'm going to milk that until I absolutely cannot
That's
anymore.
Fine.
It's like, Shelby, that was 4 years
ago. Right. Honestly, like, for the most part, besides a little bit of, like, lethargy and brain fog, like, I'm fine.
Yeah.
And those can last for months, but it's fine. But yeah, so he, yeah.
It's
anyway,
fine.
He was... He was a middle-aged white dude in power.
Yes.
Of course he believes that middle-aged white dudes should remain in power.
Yes.
Duh. But yeah, so he is the one who, like, officially changed that to
well,
we
good.
People of the United States, which is arguably one of the most famous, like, words in American history.
Yeah.
Like, famous phrases.
Yeah.
So, you know, I guess he did something
yeah.
for our country. and then, you know how I said he didn't marry until he was 57?
Uh-huh.
Now we're going to talk about that.
Okay.
So, in 1809, he threw a Christmas party. And while this party was, like, at its peak, he was like, hold on, guys, I got something to announce to you. And so, he surprised everyone by announcing that he had just wed his brand new housekeeper.
Interesting. Well, hold on. Mister, you can't vote unless your landowning aristocracy is marrying the housekeeper. I'm not saying that's a bad thing.
Oh, see.
That doesn't mesh.
She originally came from a wealthy landowning family, though.
Gotcha. Okay.
We're going to talk about why she was a housekeeper.
I was going to say.
But also, she was 22 years his junior, which, again, for the times, is
that's
not necessarily
normal.
Uncommon.
No, that
but,
was,
like, yeah.
Back in the day, especially at this, and up through, like, the 1800s, especially, this kind of tapered off during, like, the Industrial Revolution, it was very common for much older men to marry younger women because they were like, I'm 50, I need to have kids.
Yeah, it
you
was
know,
so that
it
they could continue the family line. It was
yeah.
that they needed to produce an heir.
Yeah, and that was why, too,
so,
like, if they had married at the age of 18 and then their wife died when they were all 50, they would marry someone who was 18 because they needed more kids. Like, that
yep.
was, like, that was very, very normal for the time.
Yep.
So, yeah.
Yep. Yep. but, yeah. So, his new wife was Anne Carey Randolph. She went by Nancy, so I will be calling her Nancy Randolph. Her marriage to Gouverneur was especially scandalous because she and her brother-in-law, Richard Randolph, had previously been accused of, trigger warning, murdering a newborn baby.
Oh!
Which was suspected to have been their illegitimate child.
Oh, good.
That is not where I thought that was going.
Yeah.
We've been doing
that
a lot
yeah.
today.
So, basically, what happened in that situation is Nancy lived on a plantation, and side note, this plantation was named Bizarre, which is just funny to me.
Was it spelled, like, Weird Bizarre?
Yes.
Or, like, okay, or, like, Market Bizarre?
Like, Weird Bizarre. It was B-I-Z-A-R-R-E.
Interesting.
Yes. So Nancy lived on this plantation with her sister Judith and Judith's
husband,
Richard Randolph.
Okay.
Somewhere, like, one of their brothers was, like, married to, like, George Washington's daughter or something. I don't know. It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
They were originally from, like, a wealthy landowning family.
Yeah.
So, yeah, Nancy, Judith, and Richard all lived on Bizarre, the plantation. And in 1793, Nancy and Richard were accused of having an affair and murdering their child in order to cover it up.
Hmm. Yikes.
Yeah. So, Richard ended up standing trial for that crime, but he was acquitted. And then they all went back to living on this plantation together. But then in 1796,
mm-hmm.
Richard suddenly died.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was just Nancy and Judith at the plantation. And then in 1805, Judith apparently asked Nancy to leave.
Gotcha.
So,
interesting.
In 1809, she left the plantation, essentially had nowhere else to go, so she started working as a housekeeper for Gouverneur.
Gotcha.
They had previously known each other because they, like, ran in the same
mm-hmm.
Crowds and stuff.
Yeah.
Like, wealthy landowners.
They all
blah,
knew
blah, blah.
Each other. Like.
Exactly. So basically, he, like, gave her the job because he was like, well, yeah, I guess I'll take you in. Mm-hmm. And then soon after, they decided to get married. Apparently, by all accounts, it was a happy marriage.
I have a question real quick on the math. How old were they when she got married? How old was she when they got married? Sorry, I phrased that wrong.
He was 57.
And how old was she?
35, which is very old for a woman.
Okay, for some reason I thought she was like 18, and so I was like, how could she have had a baby like 10 years before that? I misheard, and I got in my head that she was a teenager.
Years
his
junior, okay. But yeah, that puts her at 35.
Gotcha. I assumed she was a teenager. That was my bad. Yeah. Okay, we're good.
No, you're good, you're
I
good.
I was just slightly concerned, like, how did this all happen?
Right. Yeah, but by all accounts, it was a happy marriage. They had a son together who was Gouverneur Morris Jr., who had a long career as a railroad executive. You know. I didn't see anything on whether he stopped having affairs when he got married, but I'm gonna say no.
Yeah, I was wondering that.
I'm just gonna go out on a limb and say no.
Yeah, well, and I mean, I'm assuming that Nancy would have known about his reputation beforehand.
Exactly.
She may have expected those to continue.
Yeah, I think it was... It might have been a happy marriage, but I also think it was more a marriage of convenience than anything else.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Yeah.
They just both got what they wanted slash needed out of it. So it was fine. All right. And then this is our last point. Sorry. I'm really bad at telling you when to go to the next slide. Slide 6 is a picture of Nancy.
Okay.
You can go to slide 7. Which does not have a picture, and I will tells you why.
Yep.
but anyway, in 1816, but also, so in 1816, Gouverneur passed away, and this was because, he had had a blockage in his urinary tract. Today, they suspect that he had prostate cancer, but they're not sure, and regardless, it doesn't really matter anymore. But instead of going to a doctor, Gouverneur attempted to perform surgery on himself.
Oh, no!
He was a lawyer, so you know he was also a doctor.
Right, of course. So he used a piece of whalebone as a catheter to try and clear the blockage.
Oh, my God.
Are whalebones fucking huge?
Okay, what I'm assuming is because they used to use whalebone, which they actually still do sometimes, as...
Like for needles?
Well, they used it for needles, and they also used it as the boning in corsets.
Yeah.
So did he take one of those?
Okay. I think so.
Oh my God, those things aren't like...
A fucking whale.
Those aren't urinary tract sized.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So,
like a 3-inch in diameter bone.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah. Oh so, my God. The dude took a piece of whalebone, tried to stick it up a hole that is not whalebone sized, and
my cat is staring at me like I'm a fucking idiot.
He ended up obviously causing himself internal injuries and a very nasty infection.
Yeah.
Because he did not clean the bone before he used it, you know?
Yes, that was the clincher. It was because he didn't clean it.
You know, it's fine. And so that led to his death on November 6th of 1816.
He died.
And that's all I got for you today.
Up his dick. I'm sorry. That's hysterical. It's not. I feel bad for laughing, but also not. Because, like, really?
Yep. That's Gouverneur Morris,
and what,
one of our
what year,
founding fathers.
What year did he die?
1816.
Okay.
So if anyone else is like, but our Constitution says, I'll be like, yeah, but the guy who wrote the Constitution killed himself by sticking a whalebone up his penis. So maybe we should reinterpret those words or think about it in 2021 context, okay?
I really wish I'd known about this in law school.
Because, you know what? You know what I have been using all these years? The arguments that the founding father didn't know how to properly wash their dicks. But
this is so much better.
This is so much better. It's so much more better. Specific. It has...
so much more poignant.
You've got a name to put to it.
Yeah.
Yes, a name, a face.
It's just so much more effective.
He's literally the man who wrote the Constitution.
Yeah.
Yes, he had help, but, you know.
And, like, he was supposed to be a smart one of them. You know what I mean? Like, he was smart.
Yeah.
For the time period.
Yeah. This dude had many degrees. You know, he's got a bachelor's.
For the time, especially.
A master's. He was a lawyer. Yeah. Like, this dude's supposed to be smart.
Oh, my God, that's hysterical.
Yeah, so,
Oh, man.
There is your, ammunition if anyone ever tries to tell you that the Constitution says we should do something.
I'm so mad I didn't know about this in law school!
So, hopefully, Shannon specifically requested a funny topic for today's episode because she had a rough day.
I'm glad that all worked out.
That was funny enough to... bring you out of the funk. I know the first part of it was not as amusing, but...
oh, man. That's okay. It all worked out. We're good.
I had to give you some background to build up to that.
Yeah. It's all good.
So.
I love it.
I love it. This is the kind of stuff that, like, this is... why I like history so much is because, like, a lot of people think, like, our ancestors were so, like, noble and, like, well-behaved.
No, they were just a bunch of idiots, they were too, just a bunch who didn't of know how to be adults.
They were just a bunch of idiots who didn't know what germs were.
We're still idiots. Everyone's
idiot. We're still idiots. They were also idiots.
Oh, for sure.
Like.
Yeah.
And. They weren't any better than we were.
Part of me wishes I still had my history book from high school because it would just throw in random little tidbits like that.
I love that.
Like, I don't know. It was my AP US history textbook, and it was, I don't know. There was something about Pennsylvania, I think. And it just, like, in parentheses, it had nothing to do with anything, and it was just talking about the state of Pennsylvania, and it was like, side note, jousting is the, like, state sport of Pennsylvania. I was like, but why did I need to know that? But I still remember it to this day.
See,
so,
but, like, that's a good way to get, especially, like, teenagers and kids, that's a really good way to get younger people interested in history.
Yeah, and it was, like, talking about Abraham
Lincoln.
It's by
making
it
weird.
Talking, right? Like, it was talking about Mary Todd Lincoln, and it was, like, who was commonly known by her peers as the She-Wolf. I mean, which, to be fair, Mary Todd Lincoln was a little cuckoo, but...
she had a lot going on.
Look, she had some reasons to be cuckoo. Yeah. I'm not saying she didn't.
It was justified. Okay? She had a lot happening. And
she had a lot of children die on her, and it's okay.
And then her husband. It wasn't good.
Yeah. But she was also a very argumentative person.
Yeah.
So, anyway, make history fun. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
And that's all I got for you, so.
All right. Well, thank you. That was...
our ending is that we have no ending. So, yeah.
Yeah. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Thanks for listening to The Triad. Our music is by Scott Buckley. Our audio is recorded by our sound engineers, Craig Bott and Audrey Credo.
If you like the show, please rate, review, and subscribe on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts. You can also follow us on social media. We're on Instagram, YouTube, and Tumblr as The Triad Podcast.
We're also on Patreon as The Triad. Currently, all Patreon funds will go towards the costs of hosting the show. Each tier has its own rewards, but every patron receives our undying gratitude. Do you have comments, questions, or stories? Email us at thetriadpod@gmail.com. And thank you again for listening to The Triad, where we're spooky, but sensitive.